All right, everybody, I guess we're all ready to get started. I'm going to make this quick because I hear some people started staking out seats at 2 o'clock. It's a little crazy. First, I'd like to thank the Political Theory Project, our sponsoring organization, Professor John Tomasi, Dina Eggy, Mary Mossad. Without them, this event would not have been possible. I'd also like to thank Zach Ingber from Hillel and Felice Feit from Students for Justice in Palestine. They helped us a lot with planning the event. We got names of possible speakers, event topics from them. They were a huge help. I'd also like to thank all of you for showing up. This is really fantastic, a great turnout. And I'd like to thank our speakers, who need no introduction. If you really want a full bio, you can just look in your program. It's in there. So the format today, we're going to do 25-minute opening statements, followed by about a 5-minute rebuttal by each speaker. And then we're going to move straight to Q&A. And we're looking to finish up around 6 o'clock. So just a word about this discussion. It's obviously a divisive topic, a lot of emotions for good reason. And the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not, from either side, a civil conflict, but we're looking here to have a civil conversation. And so I would just ask that you remain respectful. This is a conversation, and I know it's sort of framed as a debate, but it's not an opportunity to yell, it's not an opportunity to stamp your feet. There are other forms for that. This is meant to be a discussion. I don't want to drive that point home too much, but it should be great. Without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Professor Chomsky. Give him a round of applause.
The question we've been asked to address is whether America's support for Israel prevents peace. And the straightforward way to address the question is simply to run through the record. So I'll keep to the parts that are well documented, and you can easily check. We'll begin in 1967, when the current period begins to develop. That's when Israel conquered the currently occupied territories. Immediately afterwards, there was a United Nations resolution, UN 242, taken since to be the sort of gold standard on the issue. It called for Israeli withdrawal in return for Arab acceptance of peace. Notice, crucially, that UN 242 was rejectionist. It offered nothing to the Palestinians. They were mentioned only rather vaguely in terms of unspecified refugee rights, but nothing about Palestinian national rights. That's important. There was an impasse. Neither side accepted it. The impasse was broken in 1971, February 1971. There was a UN negotiator, Gunnar Jahring. And through his mediation, the President Sadat of Egypt offered Israel a full peace treaty, in return for withdrawal from the Egyptian Sinai. He mentioned other territories, but he only cared about the Sinai. Actually, Jordan followed it with a similar offer in 1972. At that point, Israel had a choice, crucial choice. They had to choose between expansion and security. A peace treaty with Egypt would have meant security. It's the only significant Arab military force. But Israel rejected it. They were at the time planning extensive development projects in the Egyptian Sinai, a major port, city Yamit on the Mediterranean, lots of settlements. They were driving Bedouin out of their homes, destroying their villages, driving them into the desert, thousands of them. And they decided to pursue that policy of expansion rather than to accept what would have been peace and security. Now, the crucial question, as always, is how the U.S. would react. And there was a split in the U.S. government. The State Department pretty much supported Sadat's proposal. Henry Kissinger, the National Security Advisor, was opposed to it. And in the bureaucratic battle, he won out. His policy, as he explained, was what he called stalemate. No negotiations, just force. And at that time, it was assumed pretty widely that the Arabs had no force. Well, Sadat kept warning that if Israel refused negotiations, he would have to go to war. Yamit means war, as he put it. He expelled the Russians, tried to make good relations with the United States, but Kissinger basically disregarded him. It wasn't taken seriously. To everyone's surprise, he did launch a war in 1973, and it was a pretty close call for Israel, actually for the world. Kissinger called a nuclear alert at one point. We now know from recently declassified documents what was happening. The United States and Russia had imposed a ceasefire, but Kissinger privately informed Israel that they could violate it with impunity, which they did. The Russians then threatened to intervene if Israel continued to violate the ceasefire. Kissinger called the nuclear alert to warn them not to intervene. They backed off, so it wasn't an international crisis. But it was a close call. Kissinger then understood that the Arab states could not simply be dismissed as basket cases. He began his famous shuttle diplomacy. That led finally to the Camp David agreements, 1978-79, in which the United States and Israel pretty much accepted Sadat's 1971 proposal. But by then, in a form that was much harsher from the U.S.-Israeli point of view, because by then it included recognition of Palestinian rights. That's described here often as a diplomatic triumph. In fact, it was a diplomatic catastrophe. If the proposal had been accepted in 1971 when it was offered, it would have spared the region devastation, war, near disaster, and the world a threat. Well, that's Camp David, first Camp David. I think myself that that 1971 decision in Israel, that was the Labor Party, that was the most fateful decision in their history. They chose expansion instead of security, and that's been pretty much the story since. Well, meanwhile, in the 1970s, the issue of Palestinian nationalism did reach the international agenda. And in January 1976, there was a Security Council resolution put forth by the leading Arab states, Egypt, Jordan, and Syria, calling for what has become an overwhelming international consensus. They called for a two-state settlement on the internationally recognized border with guarantees for the rights of each state to exist in peace and security within secure and recognized borders. It's the wording of UN 242. The U.S. vetoed it. There was a similar resolution in 1980. The United States vetoed it. Diplomatic action then shifted to the General Assembly where there's no veto. I won't run through the record, but if you look year after year, there's a similar resolution at the General Assembly. The votes are 151-3, U.S., Israel, Marshall Islands, or something like that. That goes on right through the period. Meanwhile, the most recent U.S. veto in the Security Council did get some attention, because most of the time it's ignored. It was a little surprising. That was Obama, February 2011. This was a resolution calling for implementation of official U.S. policy. Official U.S. policy is opposition to expansion of the settlement. And that's what the resolution called for, but the U.S. vetoed it, which did raise a few eyebrows. It's worth bearing in mind that settlement expansion, though that's what's discussed, is a kind of a secondary issue. It's the settlements that are illegal, the settlements and the massive infrastructure programs in which they're embedded, which are expanding rapidly. That they're illegal is not seriously in question. That's been determined by the highest authorities, the Security Council, the International Court of Justice. So, for example, the Security Council in 1979 Resolution 452 declared all the settlement and development programs illegal, void. It was passed 14-0, one abstention, the United States. The International Court of Justice reached a similar conclusion in an advisory opinion. Actually, the U.S. Justice agreed with it in a separate opinion. So the illegality of the settlement programs and development programs is not seriously in question. Meanwhile, this has become an overwhelming international consensus, includes the Arab League, the Organization of Islamic States, which includes Iran, essentially the whole world outside the United States and Israel. In 1988, the Palestinian National Congress formally accepted the international consensus in those terms. Israel reacted, of course, in May 1989. Israel gave its response. This is a coalition government, two major political blocs, Labor and Likud, Yitzhak Shamir, Shimon Peres. Israel responded by saying that there can be no additional Palestinian state between Jordan and Israel. The phrase additional Palestinian state reflects the Israeli insistence that Jordan is a Palestinian state. The Jordanians don't think so, the Palestinians don't think so, but you know, what do they know? Israel claims it's a Palestinian state and there can be no additional one. Question as always, and then it continued that the fate of the occupied territories would have to be settled in accord with the guidelines of the government of Israel. I'm quoting from it. Again, question is, how will the U.S. react? It reacted a couple of months later, December 1989, the Baker Plan, James Baker, Secretary of State, which fully endorsed the Israeli position. Fully endorsed it, just repeated it, as I said. It's 1989. Shortly after that comes the Gulf War, the first Gulf War. After the Gulf War, President Bush, number one, initiated negotiations called the Madrid negotiations. There was a Palestinian, Palestinians were involved, the internal Palestinians, not the external ones who were in Tunis. The internal Palestinians were involved. They were led by probably the most respected person in the occupied territories, Haider al-Shafi, a dedicated nationalist, but they didn't get anywhere because al-Shafi refused to accept the principle of settlement expansion. That was what was at issue. He rejected that, and those negotiations were at a dead end. At about that time, Yasser Arafat, who was in Tunis, that's the external Palestinians, it made a kind of an end run around the internal Palestinians. There's interesting issues here about internal Palestinian politics. I don't have time to go into it, but he made an agreement through Norway, which led to what were called the Oslo Accords, which pretty much excluded the domestic Palestinians. Haider al-Shafi totally rejected it. That led to the famous meeting on the White House lawn, shaking hands, Bill Clinton, you know, with his arms around Arafat and Rabin and so on. A lot of euphoria about it in the United States. The press called it the Day of Awe. As I said, Abdel Shafi refused even to come. There's plenty of protest among Palestinians. And if you look at the agreement, you can see why. There was one document, a Declaration of Principles. It's a couple of pages. You can look it up on the internet. The document stated that the end result of negotiations, laid out a period of negotiations, the end result would be implementation of UN 242. But remember, UN 242 offered nothing to the Palestinians. And that was to be the end result of the negotiations. Well, I won't go through the further record, but it developed as you'd expected. The Israel under Prime Minister Rabin and Prime Minister Peres rapidly accelerated development and settlement programs in the occupied territories. They were flatly opposed to any kind of Palestinian state, said so explicitly. Shlomo Ben Ami, who was the head of the Foreign Office and one of the chief negotiators, wrote a book about it in Hebrew, unfortunately, in which he described the goal of Israel during this period, the 1990s, as establishing what he called a permanent neocolonial dependency for the Palestinians in the occupied territories. That continued until the year 2000, which in fact was the peak year of settlement, expansion of settlements. Then came the Camp David agreements of, negotiations of 2000. They didn't get anywhere. The Palestinians would not, it was recognized that no Palestinians could accept what was offered. I actually have a map of it here, but essentially the proposal was for a cantonization of the West Bank. Israel would take what's called Jerusalem. It's actually a huge area, much larger than historic Jerusalem. Greater Jerusalem extends well into the West Bank. And bear in mind that whatever Israel does in Jerusalem is doubly illegal. Not only is it illegal because everything going on in the West Bank is, but it violates specific repeated Security Council resolutions demanding that Israel terminate any change in the status of Jerusalem. So it includes this greatly expanded area, also a corridor to the east. I'm actually looking at the map. Corridor to the east, which goes virtually to the border of Jordan, the big town, Ma'al al-Dumim, is in the middle of it. It was built mostly in the Clinton years, primarily to kind of bisect the West Bank. That does virtually bisect the West Bank. There's another corridor to the north. It goes to the town of Ariel and beyond it to Shiloh, another town that pretty much bisects what's left, other settlements. Those are the programs of the 1990s. Of course, Palestinians didn't accept it. Clinton himself recognized that this was unacceptable. In December 2000, he issued what he called his parameters, which were somewhat vague, but more forthcoming. A couple of days later, January 7th, at the Israel Policy Forum, he gave an important speech in which he said that both sides had accepted his parameters, both sides had reservations. They met then in January 2001 in Taba, Egypt, to try to iron out their reservations, and they were making progress, apparently. In their final meeting, they issued a press conference. I can quote it for you here if you like. But essentially, they said that there was a lot of progress, and if they could go on a little bit longer, they might resolve everything. Well, Israel called off the negotiations. That was the end of that. They haven't resumed, formally speaking. Now, there's the top Israeli scholar scholars have written about this, Ron Pundak and Shaul Arieli. Pundak was the director of the Paris Peace Center. He's died recently. Arieli is one of the top negotiators. Here's their assessment. I'll quote it. Prior to Camp David, both sides failed to live up to their commitments, but the Israeli breaches were much more numerous, more substantive in nature. Netanyahu, after Paris and Shamir and Rabin, sabotaged the peace process relentlessly. Barak's election, Labor Party, in 1999 raised expectations, but they were dashed by his refusal to transfer to the Palestinians villages around Greater Jerusalem, and by actions on the ground, the increase in harassment, collective punishment, creation of poverty, water shortages, expanded settlement, while Palestinians were confined to Bantustan-like enclaves. And support, there was plenty of support by really ugly actions by the settlers, by the army and civil authorities. At Camp David, 2000, the Palestinian leadership and the majority of the public were ready to make necessary concessions, but needed some indication that the relation of occupied would change, and Barak, Prime Minister of Israel, did not provide these. I can go on if you like, but that's the basic tone, and that's pretty accurate by other presentations. Well, it goes on to the present. Constant Israeli expansion in the West Bank, cantonization increases, Israel's meanwhile quietly developing the Jordan Valley, big area. Palestinians are being expelled, villages are being, Israeli settlements are being built, well sunk and so on. All of this continues with full U.S. support, maybe a clucking of the tongues, but basically full support. Meanwhile, the Golan Heights, Syrian Golan Heights, Israel annexed. The Security Council instantly declared that null and void, without any legal effect, unanimous decision, no effect. Gaza and the West Bank have been separated. The Oslo agreements determined explicitly that Gaza and the West Bank are a single territorial unity, territorial integrity. At once, in 1993, the U.S. and Israel began to separate Gaza from the West Bank in violation of their commitments at Oslo. Best study of this, if you want to look at it, is by Sarah Roy, a scholar at Harvard, specialist in this. This is quite crucial, incidentally, because if you look at the geography, you'll see that any kind of autonomy that might be achieved in the West Bank would mean very little, because it would be imprisoned. The only outlet to the outside world is Gaza, and if Gaza and the West Bank are separated, then essentially there's nothing. Gaza has been under severe Israeli attack ever since 1993. It's escalated in recent years. There was settlement, Israeli settlement there, illegal, of course. In 1995, Ariel Sharon determined that it would make more sense to take the few thousand settlers in Gaza who were occupying more than a third of the territory, to take them from their illegal settlements in Gaza and move them to other illegal settlements in the West Bank. That's what was called the withdrawal, relieved a huge part of the Israeli army from protecting a few thousand settlers in Gaza. The Israeli army actually left Gaza in October 1995. The siege remained, and in January 2006, there was a free election in Palestine, carefully monitored, recognized to be free. The United States and Israel didn't like the outcome. The outcome was that Hamas essentially won the plurality. They took control. U.S. and Israel didn't like that. Both instantly imposed harsh sanctions, very harsh sanctions. The Israeli attacks continued. That's the only free election in the Arab world. Gives you a good indication of what democracy promotion means. The United States and Israel immediately began preparations for a military coup that was to take place a year later. It was preempted by Hamas. Two sides separated. Just yesterday, they reached an agreement, finally. That's what was going on in Gaza. It's been under severe sanctions, siege, constant attack. In 2008, there was a ceasefire established between Hamas and Israel. Hamas lived up to it completely. You can read the official Israeli record. There wasn't a single Hamas rocket until Israel broke the ceasefire in November 2008 by invading Gaza, killing Hamas militants. Then there was an exchange of rockets. Of course, everyone who's killed is Palestinian. The imbalance is extraordinary. Hamas offered to renew the ceasefire. Israel refused. They decided instead to launch a major attack on Gaza. That's Operation Cast Lead. It was a really vicious, brutal attack. There's plenty of documentation on this. It was studied by Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, the Goldstone Commission. And it was, if you really want to know the details, what I'd urge is reading an important book by two Norwegian physicians, Mats Gilbert and Erik Fosse, who worked at the main Gaza hospital right through it and give a kind of minute-by-minute description of what was going on. But the international human rights reports are very revealing. The UN did try to impose a ceasefire. The vote was 14-0, one abstention. The U.S. refused to vote for it. Meanwhile, the U.S. was providing weapons. Well, Gaza's kind of, it's been described as an open-air prison, which is pretty accurate. Anyone who's been there, I have, can see it right away. A bare survival. Well, that's pretty much the story. I won't go into the further details. The crucial thing is that the United States continues to provide a crucial economic, military, diplomatic, and ideological support to Israel. The ideological support is the way the issues are framed. For example, most of what I've described, though it's all fully documented, you don't read about, you don't see, you have to do research to find it out. The record's well documented, it's consistent. The United States is essentially alone in the world on this. U.S. and Israel are virtually alone. The diplomatic record reveals it, and you can see it in policy. And I think that provides a pretty clear answer to the question that was raised here. Does the U.S. Support for Israel prevent peace? Thanks.
And now, Ambassador Dennis Ross.
Well, thank you. I can see that there's actually no interest in this topic, so I guess I'll talk about it anyway. You know, it's, I have to say that, you know, Professor Chomsky is a very well-known, very respected linguist. As a professor of linguistics, it's very clear that he has a world reputation, and I wouldn't dream to challenge him on anything related to linguistics. But we're not talking about linguistics today. We are going to talk about, and we've heard about, the question of Arab-Israeli peace or efforts at peace and why it hasn't happened. And there I feel very comfortable challenging him, partly because he is not an acknowledged expert on that, partly because I've studied the history, but more importantly than that, I was a practitioner. I have been for the last 30 years someone who was involved in every effort at trying to promote peace in the area. So I know it not from secondary sources, I know it not from certain documents, I know it from firsthand experience. And I want to talk about that, and I want to take on the question that he addressed. He did address the question that the two of us were asked to come and talk about. And that specifically was, as Professor Chomsky put it, does United States support for Israel prevent peace? I want to address it because the essence of the question presumes that the reason there's no peace is because of Israel. Now, he laid out a historical record, I have to say that it obviously represents his point of view. As Daniel Patrick Moynihan used to say, everyone is entitled to their own opinion, they're just not entitled to their own facts. And what I want to do is I want to lay out a view of history that obviously differs from his. And in some cases, I will specifically challenge some of the points he's made. In other cases, I'll talk about other points that I think are relevant. But let me start, I'll go earlier than he did. He started after 67. I want to start, again, because the question, the premise of this question is that the reason there's no peace is because of Israel. If we go back to the period before the time that Israel existed, before the state, during the British Mandate period, there were proposals to try to settle the conflict between the Palestinian, the Arabs of Palestine, and the Jews of Palestine. The British were the mandatory power. In 1936, there began what would became known as the Arab Revolt. It was a revolt against the mandatory authority. It was also a revolt against the Jewish presence that was increasing in Palestine. The Royal Commission that was established to investigate the causes of the conflict there and to make recommendations for how to resolve it was called the Peel Commission, and it proposed that Palestine should be partitioned into two states, a Jewish state and an Arab state. The Arabs of Palestine rejected it. The Jewish leaders of Palestine accepted it. A decade later, the British, after having failed with a plan called the Morrison-Grady Plan, which, by the way, both the Jews and the Arabs of Palestine rejected, the British then came to the UN and said, "We want out. We're done." They turned the problem over to the UN. The UN Special Commission on Palestine then investigated, went in, assessed, made a judgment. There was a majority report and The majority report basically came to the conclusion that the only way to resolve the conflict was to partition Palestine into a Jewish state and an Arab state. So on November 29, 1947, that partition plan was voted by the UN. Once again, the Jews of Palestine accepted it, the Arabs of Palestine rejected it, and the Arabs in the region rejected it. Now let's fast forward to Camp David, which takes place September 78. It is the result of what was the Sadat initiative. Sadat goes to Jerusalem. He goes to Jerusalem after there are secret meetings between Tuhami and Dayan, meaning a minister close to him and Moshe Dayan. And in fact, the Camp David Accords, which emerged from the Camp David discussions in September of 78, have two parts to them. One part represents an Egyptian-Israeli peace treaty, and the other part represented an approach, a framework, for how to resolve the Palestinian conflict between Israelis and Palestinians. And that would have created interim self-government authority for the Palestinians that would govern over a period of a five-year transition period. At the end of that, they were supposed to resolve the permanent status issues. Now, after the Egyptian-Israeli peace treaty of 79, there were in fact negotiations between the Egyptians and the Israelis, and the Israelis at that time accepted something that the Egyptians proposed, which was that the interim self-government authority should have, in fact, a say in what happened to the use of land, meaning that if, in fact, this agreement had come into being, and if Palestinians had been part of it, and if the PLO had not rejected it, as every other, all the Arabs except for the country of Oman rejected what Sadat was doing. If this had been accepted, Palestinians would have had a veto over Israeli settlement activity at that time, at a time when you had roughly 5,000 settlers outside of Jerusalem, not the over 300,000 outside of Jerusalem that you have today. Now, in the summer of 2000, when we were at Camp David, I was President Clinton's negotiator in the Middle East. When we were at Camp David in the summer of 2000, Yasser Arafat said to me that Sadat had invited him to come to Camp David back in 78, and he wanted to go. And he said the Soviets and the Syrians prevented him from going. And I said to him, "You have a chance. Every Palestinian you know today laments that the partition plan wasn't accepted. Maybe in 1947 it was too difficult. Maybe overcoming the opposition of all the Arabs was too hard. You yourself are lamenting to me now that you wish you had gone in 1978. Okay, you were blocked at that time. Nothing blocks you today. You're the one here who can make a decision. Don't let the next generation of Palestinians look back and lament that there was a possibility of saying yes and you said no." And here I have to, here there's a specific point of fact that I have to correct. There was not a plan at Camp David that was a Cantonization plan. There are maps that were produced that are completely inauthentic. On this one, I was there. We presented parameters at Camp David. We presented no maps. The only maps that existed that show what was really offered at Camp David are in my book, The Missing Piece. Those are authentic because the maps didn't exist, except for the fact that I then had them drawn. They do not show a Cantonization, but that was rejected. We didn't quit. As Professor Chomsky said, it's true. We didn't quit after Camp David. We did not quit after Camp David. Is that from The Missing Piece?
Where it comes from.
The Missing Piece?
From.
Was he at Camp David?
Arielle.
Was he at Camp David? No, he was not. He was not there. I know what was presented. We're the ones who presented it to Arafat. The Israelis didn't. We did. All right? We presented it. And the Clinton parameters, you know who the main author of the Clinton parameters was? You're looking at it. I was the main author of the Clinton parameters. Now, we did that at the end of December. The Israeli government voted for accepting the Clinton parameters. And I want to note, by the way, the Intifada had erupted, and Yasser Arafat was behind the Intifada. We went ahead anyway. And we did the Clinton parameters, which you are quite right. They went well beyond what was offered at Camp David. They offered basically a Palestinian state with a capital in Jerusalem where all the Arab neighbors, what was Arab would be Palestinian, including in the Old City. And what was Jewish would be Israeli. 100% of Gaza would be given up. Most of the West Bank would be given up. Now, here again, Arafat said no. You quoted what President Clinton said in his IPF speech. January 2nd, we had a meeting in the White House in the Oval Office with the President, me, and Arafat. And there, Arafat rejected the Clinton parameters. There is a reason that the President said that both sides offered reservations. The reason was that Barack basically didn't want us to say that that Arafat had rejected it because he was in an election campaign against Sharon. But the fact is that Arafat rejected it. Every single thing that he was asked to compromise on his side, he rejected, every single point. So he said no at Camp David when there wasn't Cantonization. He said no to a better deal with the Clinton parameters, and he promoted an intifada. By saying no to the Clinton parameters, the message to the Israeli public was that basically nothing will satisfy them. And the Intifada wasn't just a rejection of the most forthcoming government in Israel's history. It was also then violence. And the violence, which began after Sharon went to the Temple Mount, was completely orchestrated by the Palestinians at that time. Arafat did nothing to stop that violence. The violence then, in 2001, became characterized by suicide bombings. Suicide bombings of buses, of cafes, of hotels, of nightclubs. And that killed the peace camp in Israel. And one of the reasons that we're, in a sense, things have evolved the way they have is because those who were the strongest constituency for peace within Israel were the ones who became discredited because of what happened. Now, I should add, just on the point on Taba, the fact of what happened at Taba, Taba was held the first week of the Bush administration. What happened at Taba, it's true, what you said about what they said at the end. What isn't the case, however, is that this was before the Israeli election. The Israeli negotiators who were there wanted the Palestinians to agree to what was on the table so they could hold that up. They didn't think that Barack was going to win at that point. They thought Sharon was going to win at that point. And they wanted an agreement that could then be used to try to hold Sharon to something. And Arafat refused. Not the Palestinian negotiators there, but Arafat refused. All right, that's not the end of the story here. You not only have the Intifada that goes on, but you then have, in 2005, Sharon's decision to withdraw from Gaza. Now, he withdraws from Gaza, and he pulls out all the settlers and all the soldiers. I went into Gaza and gave a speech. A Palestinian friend of mine, Ziad Abu Amr, asked me to come and speak in Gaza a couple months before the Israelis pulled out. And I said, and I didn't know, he didn't tell me, that the whole opposition, the whole leadership of Hamas was going to be there as well as the members of Fatah. And I said to this audience of several hundred, I said, you have a unique opportunity now. You can show the world and you can show the Israelis, you can show the Israeli public that you can turn Gaza into something. You can turn it into a going concern. And you can prove to the Israeli public that if it can work in Gaza, then you can do the same thing in the West Bank as well. But if you turn Gaza into a platform for attacks against Israel after you pull out, who in Israel is going to say, oh, we can also do this in the West Bank? In the West Bank that sits astride every Israeli central population area? The answer is going to be nobody. So here's your opportunity. Take advantage of it. And what happened? The first week after the Israelis withdrew from Gaza, you talked about a siege of Gaza. The siege of Gaza didn't exist when the Israelis withdrew. The first week after the Israelis withdrew, there were attacks. So you withdraw from territory and you get attacks. The principle of 242 was supposed to be land for peace. It wasn't supposed to be land for nothing. It wasn't supposed to be land for violence. It was supposed to be land for peace, land for security. The Israelis withdrew from Gaza, and what they got was not anything but violence. By the way, Barak had withdrawn from Lebanon in May of 2000. Same thing happened there. Hezbollah looked at the withdrawal as a sign of victory for resistance, not an indication that if the Israelis withdraw from territory, you should take advantage of it. All right, the last effort, less serious effort, apart from what's been going on recently, we can talk about that in our discussion later on. Olmert offers a proposal to Abu Mazen in 2008. He and Abu Mazen had been meeting privately, and finally he came and he said, look, let's cut through it all. And he presented a proposal. The proposal was something that actually went beyond the Clinton parameters. On Jerusalem, it was very similar to Clinton, but on the territory, it was actually better from a Palestinian standpoint. Because in the West Bank, he was going to preserve blocks of about 6.3% of the territory, and he was going to swap 5.8% from territory within Israel for that, and then you were talking about the gap between Gaza and the West Bank, he was going to create safe passage through Israel, because Israel separates Gaza and the West Bank. He was going to create safe passage to make up for the 0.5% that he wasn't compensating with the 5.8 to 6.3. Abu Mazen didn't give an answer. He didn't say yes, he didn't say no, he didn't give a response. Now, I recite the history for a reason. If you say that Israel is the reason there's no peace, history belies that. That's just not the reality. Now, when I say this, does this mean that I think that everything the Israelis have done has contributed to peace? No. Do I think that this is a morality play where one side is all right and the other is all wrong? No, I don't. I've spent too much time as a mediator between the two sides. But the fact is, you can't say that Israel is the only reason there's no peace. And when I say that the settlements obviously don't contribute to peace, that's a fact. They don't contribute to peace. They make the Palestinians feel powerless. And they raise the political cost within Israel of doing a deal. But do the settlements actually prevent an agreement? Well, let's see. The Israelis had settlements in the Sinai, and they withdrew from Sinai, including the settlements. The Israelis had settlements in Gaza, and they withdrew from Gaza, including the settlements. When we have been talking, going back to what was being proposed first in Camp David, then in the Clinton parameters, we talked about settlement blocks and swaps. To understand the nature of when you hear the term settlement blocks, to understand this, five settlements out of 120 represent 45% of the settler population. What we were suggesting in the Clinton parameters was settlement blocks of 5%, which would accommodate 80% of the settlers. There is a way to deal with the settlement issue as part of a negotiation where you define the borders and where you produce blocks, and then you compensate the Palestinians for the blocks. That's what 67 and mutually agreed swaps means. All right. How much more time do I have?
In between 5 and 10 minutes.
Okay. I don't want to exceed my time limits. All right, I want to make a couple other comments. I want to say something about the nature of U.S. support for Israel. It is true that the U.S. support for Israel is profound. There's no doubt about it. From 48 to 67, we provided the Israelis essentially very little support. The French provided their arms, and the German reparations provided the key to their economic development. The U.S. doesn't begin to provide serious military support to the Israelis really until the 73 war. The first arms we sell, first significant arms we sell, are in the Kennedy administration and its Hawk anti-aircraft missiles. The first aircraft are sold by Lyndon Johnson. In the 73 war, for the first week of the war, when you talk about, Professor Chomsky talks about Henry Kissinger and stalemate, he viewed when the war broke out, he felt the war, if the war ended in a stalemate, it would create the potential for diplomacy. And because he assumed at the beginning of the war that Israel had all the advantages and would win the war decisively, we don't provide resupply to the Israelis for the first week of the war. The Egyptians and the Syrians launched the war on Yom Kippur, and the Soviets are providing massive resupply. We don't provide resupply until 1 week into the war. Kissinger thought that Sadat was going to accept a ceasefire resolution that would have been a ceasefire in place. That would have created, in a sense, that Egypt had gained something, would have produced the need for diplomacy then to come in and try to begin to resolve the issues. When Sadat turned it down, it was only at that point, in the face of massive Soviet resupply, that we did then begin to resupply the Israelis. And this is a turning point in the U.S. relationship with Israel. The larger turning point in terms of institutionalizing the provision of arms and money comes first with the Sinai II Agreement in 1975. In 1975, Israel pulls back. There were two disengagements in the Sinai. The first one was away from the Suez Canal. The second one took the Israelis east of the passes within the Sinai. At the time, the United States provided very significant assurances as well as assistance. That was much larger than with the Camp David Accords and the Egyptian-Israeli Peace Treaty. And that institutionalized the kind of assistance that we then provided to the Israelis from then on. The formula, the Camp David formula, is $3 billion a year for the Israelis, $2 billion a year for Egypt. And so that was, military support and economic support was critical to Israel. Through the 1980s, actually George Shultz provided a massive supplemental to the Israelis at a time when they're suffering from hyperinflation. You see a change from all economic assistance to all military assistance during the George W. Bush administration. Now the question might be, does Israel need this kind of support? Well, look at the region. Right? Take Iran. You know, the Supreme Leader of Iran says that Israel is a cancerous tumor. They say Israel should be wiped off the map. And they provided Hezbollah 100,000 rockets. In 2006, when Hezbollah came across the border after Israel had withdrawn from Lebanon to kidnap Israeli soldiers, they fired lots of rockets into Israel. Yes, Israel hit Lebanon very hard, just as later on they would hit Gaza very hard. That ceasefire, by the way, it's true, there was a ceasefire. And in November, there was a shell left over, a Hamas shell that exploded. They claimed it killed Palestinians. They then sent rockets into Israel. Israel then retaliated. You know, there are these cycles that take off. You know, there is a reality in this region. Look at the war in Syria. The wars here are wars that tend to be total. What's happening in Syria is a stain on the international conference, a conscience, where you can actually have barrel bombs, artillery aircraft used on civilian populations, and it's just taken as a given somehow. The reality is Israel lives in a tough neighborhood. We have given assistance, military assistance to Israel for two sets of reasons. One has been to make it easier for them to take risk for peace, and two has been for deterrence. Now, Sadat, when he made peace with Israel, said, you know, I could fight Israel, but I couldn't fight the United States. So the U.S.-Israeli connection has been part of the deterrence. The value of doing that, I think, is, look at this region. Look at the nature of upheaval in the region today. And I want to close with one point. The conflicts you see in this region today are largely over identity. You see it in Iraq, you see it in Syria, and this is going to go on. This is upheaval that is going to go on for the next 10 to 20 years. Now, when you look at a region that is characterized by this kind of instability, there is actually one state in the region that is governed by a rule of law, that has an independent judiciary, that has a separation of powers, that has regular elections, and those who run the elections, when they lose, they accept the outcomes. It has freedom of speech. It has a free press. Journalists don't get put in jail. It respects women's rights. It respects gay rights. It has artistic freedom. You look at movies like The Gatekeepers that documents the living heads of Shin Bet who talk about the impact of occupation not just on the Palestinians but on Israelis, who make movies like Bethlehem, which does the same thing. The one state that is like that in this region is Israel. And for that reason alone, even though it is not a perfect state, and one has to try to deal with this conflict and end it, but given the fact that it is that kind of a state, it is deserving of American support.
Well, I agree with Ambassador Ross on one statement, that everyone's entitled to their own opinion, but they're not entitled to their own facts. So what I would suggest to you, I won't review it, is that you look at the documented facts from 67 to the present. I'm not talking about people's impressions. I'm not talking about the feelings of the negotiators on either side. They are what they are. But there's also a documentary record. I'll just talk about a couple of the points that were raised. Let's begin with the map at the Camp David map. Ambassador Ross is correct to say that there's no official map. The United States and Israel never presented an official map. Now, there was, however, a map constructed by the leading Israeli specialists and participants. Shaul Arieli, as you know, was the head of the Israeli delegation. His associate, Ron Pundak, has been involved in negotiations for years and is the leading Israeli scholar on this. This is the map that they constructed. You can look at it if you like. I sort of described it. But there really isn't any point debating it, because this map is a subset of what now exists. If you take a look at what's going on since Oslo, since Camp David, up to the present, with full U.S. support, you will see that it simply, you can't see it, but if you want to look at it, you can, it simply fills out and expands the map that Pundak and Arieli constructed from the Camp David Accords. So there's really nothing to debate about that. That's what's happening in the West Bank. Cantonized, broken up, illegal Israeli settlements, 500,000 illegal Israeli settlers, no doubt about the legality. The U.S., as I mentioned, is alone in the world outside of Israel in questioning this. Actually, the U.S. accepted it as well until 1979. The U.S. also called the settlements illegal. Under Reagan, that was downgraded to an obstacle to peace. Under Obama, it's been downgraded still more to not helpful to peace. The international institutions, Security Council, International Court of Justice, the rest of the world say simply illegal, criminal, all with U.S. support, all exactly like this. It is true, as Ambassador Ross said, that Israel pulled out of Gaza, of Sinai in 1979, actually 1982. The reason was they were exactly what I said. There was a proposal. They were offered full peace in 1971 if they withdrew from Sinai. They refused with U.S. support. that led to the 1973 war. It was a very close call for Israel, a danger to the world. After that come years of negotiations. They finally accepted what they rejected in 1971. That was the withdrawal from Sinai. What about Gaza? There were several, 6,000 or 7,000 Israeli settlers in Gaza, taking up some 30% or 40% of the land, substantial part of the resources, 1.5 million people there, large part of the Israeli army protecting them. Sharon made the sensible decision from the position of Israeli hawks that this was pointless and that they should move those settlers to illegal settlements in the West Bank. The Israeli army left Gaza in October 2005. The siege continued, it's a brutal siege, and military action succeeded. January 1976, okay, a couple months later, came the free election, and the U.S.-Israeli stepping up, harshly stepping up the attack on Gaza. By June of that year, Israel had already attacked Gaza with 7,700 rockets. These are serious rockets. They're not things made in the backyard. That was by June. Then it stepped up still further. Then came the aborted coup, stepped up still further. That's not a withdrawal. Gaza remains under siege, severe siege. The Gaza fishermen are not permitted to go more than 3 or 4 kilometers offshore, which means they can't fish, because Israel has destroyed the sewage and power plants, so it's all hopelessly polluted. The border, Israel has taken a substantial part of the internal borders of Gaza. Those are called zones in which Palestinians are not allowed to enter. If they do, they get shot at and killed. The place, and now it's even worse because the military government in Egypt has largely shut off the one entry point, but the siege remains bitter, brutal. That's a war. In some periods, like cast lead, it was a shocking, horrifying war, bitterly condemned by the entire world, again, outside the United States, and as I said, reviewed in detail by Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, UN Commission. You can read it and see. Well, when we look at the situation now, let's take a look at the settlement blocks. The settlement blocks break up, you look at their current map, they break up the West Bank into unviable cantons. They are all illegal. There's no question of leaving the settlement blocks under Israeli control. That's like saying if I say, I conquer your house, and then I leave and decide I'll take the main rooms, you can have the rest. That's not a settlement. A settlement is get out of my house. And that's what happened in 1960. Now, I'll end up simply by saying that I think Ambassador Ross gave a very accurate account of the Israeli government position of what they believe and would like people to believe. But that's just the problem. As long as the United States is the partisan of Israel, is the supporter of Israel, negotiations in which the United States organizes them are senseless. I mean, it's as if there are conflicts in Iraq between the Shia and the Sunni. Suppose somebody said, well, fine, let's let Iran run negotiations to settle them. The United States is a participant in the conflict. You could hear that from Ambassador Ross's depiction of it. U.S. is a participant, stands alone against the world with Israel, against the international, the Security Council, the Court of Justice, the huge international consensus, which includes everyone. And as long as that continues, prospects for peace are very dim.
First, I do want to say there is one, you okay? I know. I mean, you're already wearing a cast. All right, I do want to say there is one historical fact on which we agree. So just so you can leave here and say, gee, there was actually one historical fact on which they agreed. I do think one of the historical mistakes the Israelis made, and it was Golda Meir, you can read about some of Rabin's angst over this at the time, was the behavior in 71. Not seeing Sadat, that Sadat actually was making serious proposals at the time. Sadat is, in fact, was the one Arab leader, later King Hussein, but one Arab leader who was prepared to actually make initiatives. Now, let me make a second broad point. The essence of what you're saying is, as long as the US is involved in any peacemaking, it'll never happen. You know, one of the interesting things is when I was a negotiator, the Europeans used to come to me all the time and say, how come you keep us out of the negotiations? Why are you keeping us out of the negotiations? And I said to them, I have never kept you out of the negotiations. It is not me who's keeping you out of the negotiations. You know, if the Israelis and the Palestinians want you in, you're in the negotiations whether I want you in or I don't want you in. And if the Israelis and the Palestinians don't want you in, even if I want you in, you won't be in. Now, the fact of the matter is, you know, they didn't. I can understand the Israelis, but the Palestinians didn't open up to them at this time. Now, they made a judgment that they wanted us to play this role. You know, when I talked about speaking in Gaza, when I spoke to a few months before the Israeli withdrawal, and when I said here was a great opportunity for the Palestinians in Gaza to show the world and to show the Israeli public what it meant. And, you know, I said at the time, because I was speaking to obviously many who were not just Fatah, but members of the opposition as well, I said, I know you don't think the United States is an honest broker. I said, the United States has a special relationship with Israel. That's true. And it will always have a special relationship with Israel. It doesn't mean that it can't have a relationship with you and a good relationship with you. The truth is, in any negotiation, what you want is an effective broker. That's what matters. You know, whenever you hear someone say, well, we don't like the honest broker, what they want is they want someone who's on their side. But brokers, in the end, can't produce agreements unless they respond to the needs of both sides. You know, frequently when the U.S. is mediating, we're trying to find out, all right, what is the essence of each side's needs? And because we have the relationship with the Israelis, who do you think is the one who's then trying to move the Israelis? It's the U.S. And that's been the case throughout. One of the interesting dynamics, and I'm doing a book right now on the history of the U.S.-Israeli relationship, one of the interesting dynamics that you can find going back, by the way, to 1971, there's an exchange that Kissinger has with Ibn and Rabin after Yaring has posed his questions and Sadat has responded to the questions and the Israelis haven't. And Kissinger says to Ibn and Rabin, why can't you tell us what you can do? We're your friends, tell us. And the dynamic is one that gets repeated over and over and over again because the Israelis hear us and they say, whatever we tell you will never be enough because you're going to try to satisfy the Arabs. The essence of mediation is trying to find ways to reconcile both sides' needs, not only one side's needs. And when you say about the issue of, you know, I don't want you in my house, get out of my house, it's fine to get out of the house. But when you get out of the house and then you get shot at after you get out of the house, it makes you rather hesitant to get out of the house. Now, the truth is, having withdrawn unilaterally twice from Lebanon, having withdrawn from Gaza, each time after having withdrawn, not having gotten security, you know, having gotten, when you talked about the rockets the Israelis fire in, if you number the rockets that have been fired into Israel from Gaza and that were fired in the 2006 war from Lebanon, those number in the thousands and thousands of rockets as well. The issue of settlement blocks is legitimate from one standpoint because it's going to be compensated. The whole idea of 67 and mutual agreed swaps is that, all right, there will be a way to accommodate the settlers in settlement blocks that'll become part of Israel. And in return for that, you compensate the Palestinians with territory that is presently Israel. So you get a compensation. It isn't the case that, in fact, you know, outside the blocks, the settlements remain. What is the case is that you may, this is a way you can deal with the fact that you have a way to accommodate those settlers who could remain who live close to what was the Green Line. The Green Line was what existed on June 4, 67. So if you can accommodate that by, say, 5% of the West Bank, and then you compensate for that, that is a way to address the needs of both sides. And when you're trying to deal, as I said, with a conflict of this sort, if you address one side's needs, there isn't peace.
All right, so we have plenty of time for Q&A. I'm going to turn it over to the moderator, Peter McClough.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming. This part is what I hope will be one of the most constructive and one of the most enjoyable portions of the evening, which will be the Q&A session. But before we begin, I want to lay a few brief parameters. One is that I ask that we limit the mics to three people in line. That's just for the sake of visibility so that people can see back in the back of the auditorium. So three in line, please, at a time. Secondly, as is easy to do at Brown University, we often confuse length with insight. So please, please keep your questions brief, and that's really for the purpose of getting as many questions asked as we can. With that, I'm going to begin with the young lady on the left.
Hi, my name is Reva. I'm a senior here, and I'd like to thank Professor Chomsky and Dr. Ross, or Ambassador Ross, for coming. So I had one question that I don't know if either of you addressed, which is the Cold War. And I'd like to call, since Ambassador Ross raised Professor Chomsky's credentials in the beginning, I'd like to raise your credentials now as well. You graduated with a degree in Soviet decision making. So I'd like to ask why, I guess, you believe that the United States should continue a practice of supporting what is essentially a pawn in a Cold War conflict into a post-Cold War era.
Say it again. Why?
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Let me clarify.
It's okay. It's fine.
So, and just to clarify that, I know you said let length. No, that's really. But I guess the, as a student.
No, you were so succinct that
yeah, I
didn't quite
I really
understand
to,
what you're getting at. So explain it.
So I had one serious issue with a comment you made about identity and how the conflict in the Middle East right now. Israel is living in a tough neighborhood, and you know it's racked. The Middle East is racked by these primordial conflicts of identity, and you know can't Israel is therefore the only stable haven of democracy in the Middle East. But if you look at the history of how that democracy came into being, and if you look at the history of how those authoritarian leaders in those states were put in place, it's inextricably connected with the Cold War and with Soviet and US decision making. So I'm struggling to understand why we continue to act as if the entire Arab world, you use the word Arab and you use the word Arabs in Palestine, which first of all is extremely ethnocentric and I mean painful in a sense. But why should we continue to act as if we're in this, you know, epic war with a Soviet power and we're the on the other side and this is our playground?
Okay, I got it. Thank you. No, I think, look, I wanted to be sure I understood what
yeah,
you were asking.
Sorry, and I'm really sorry, but...
Go ahead. No, go ahead, Ambassador Ross.
You were fair. I would say that I don't think U.S. policy towards the Middle East today is driven by a Cold War mentality. It is true. If you go back, if you actually look at President Obama's speech that he gives in Cairo in June of 2009, one of the things he says is that the U.S. and the West approached the region through a Cold War approach for too long, and that helped, and we treated too many of those in the region as proxies for us. I don't think that's the nature of our approach today. And when I was trying to suggest what's going on in the region right now, there are conflicts that are driven by tribe, clan, and sect today. Now, what the U.S. does in this region, I think, has to be driven by a combination of values and interests. That's usually what drives American foreign policy. You view the creation of Israel as a crime, correct?
No, I don't actually. I think that's a harmful assumption.
Hold on, Reva, wait one second. We're going to try and limit dialogue between
okay, all right.
I know Ambassador Ross asked the question, but just for future, we're going to try and limit dialogue.
I don't want to mischaracterize you either. I'm sorry, I don't want to mischaracterize you, really.
Yeah. That's it.
There's a colloquy going on, which is kind of interesting, but okay. I think the American approach to the region is, in the long term, will be best served if it's driven by our embrace of a certain set of values. That's true. Is it always easy for us to do that without regard to our interests? No, it's not so easy to do that without regard to our interests. But I don't believe that today we're approaching this, even though Vladimir Putin is doing his best to recreate the Soviet Union, I don't believe that we are approaching this through a Cold War mindset. I think we're struggling to deal with how to cope with a region that's going to be characterized by upheaval for some time to come.
Well, here we have a measure of agreement. I also don't think that policy is driven by a Cold War mentality, but in fact, I don't think it ever was. Just take a look at the facts. So for example, take 1989, when the Soviet Union was collapsing, Berlin Wall fell, you know, it's finished. What was the U.S. policy? Well, I quoted it. It was the Baker Plan, December 1989. Read it. What it says is there can be no additional Palestinian state in addition to Jordan, which we declare to be a Palestinian state, despite what they think. There can be no additional Palestinian state between Jordan and Israel, and the outcome of the occupied territories must be settled according to the guidelines of the State of Israel. James Baker went on to add that Palestinians could take part in negotiations as long as they accepted that their role is to accept the Israeli guidelines. That's when Soviet Union was collapsing. Nothing about the Cold War. I won't go through the earlier record, but it's the same. And up until today, there's no Cold War, and the policy gets harsher and harsher. If you look back, and let's ask whether it's driven by values. Actually, I don't think great powers ever act in terms of their professed values. Everyone professes all kind of wonderful values. Now look at the facts. So take, say, the Arab world. There has been one free election, one, January 2006 in Palestine, free election. How did the U.S. react? Well, it reacted by harshly punishing the Palestinians because they voted the wrong way. They voted a way we didn't like. So therefore, the U.S. and, of course, Israel imposed harsh sanctions, escalated the attack on Gaza, and expanded settlement in the West Bank, and prepared a military coup to overthrow the government. Incidentally, there are people who understand this. It's useful to look at the attitude towards us held by others. It's not enough just to look at a mirror and say how beautiful we are. So what do Arabs think, for example, about our value of democracy? You can find that out. There's regular polls by the leading U.S. polling agencies of opinion in the Arab world. They happen to be collected conveniently in a recent book by Shibli Talhami, who's the professor who runs most of these. One of the questions that's asked is, among in the Arab world is, What's your attitude? Do you support, is there attitude towards the U.S. policy of what's called democracy promotion? You know what percentage of Arabs take it seriously? 5%. The rest dismiss it. They say the U.S. is following great power interests, wants to control the oil of the Arab world, wants to dominate it, and so on. 5% agree with the official U.S. line. We're pursuing our value of democracy. Are we pursuing peace? Well, we can find out about that, too. Last December, for example, there was an international poll run by the main polling agencies, Gallup in the United States, its counterpart in England. One of the questions that was asked is, which country is the greatest threat to world peace? The United States, nobody else was even close. The United States was far in the lead. Pakistan was way behind. Nobody, practically nobody else was mentioned. Well, what is the world?
All right, about 10 more seconds, Professor Jones.
That's the world. What do they know? Of course, Americans don't know this for a good reason. There was not a single report about it in the United States. It's considered insignificant. What do we care what the world thinks? What do we care what the Arab world thinks about our attitude toward democracy? We just look at ourselves and pat ourselves on the back about how we pursue our values.
Thank you. And we're going to move right here on the right to the next question, please.
Great. First of all, I want to say thank you to the students who organized the Janus Forum. Thank you for giving us this opportunity. We really appreciate it. My name is Cliff Weitzman. I'm a sophomore here at Brown. I want to start by also thanking you guys, Ambassador Ross and Professor Chomsky, for coming to speak to us today. I really appreciate the opportunity to learn from you, even though I don't necessarily agree with some of your opinions. So I grew up in Israel. I moved to the U.S. when I was 13, and after Sharon gave away massive amounts of Gaza to Palestinians, I experienced some of that backlash. When Hamas sent Qassam rockets, I was cowering in a basement and afraid of getting hit. Same thing goes for all my siblings. A lot of this speech has been about allocating blame. I think that's the wrong way to go, because both sides are wrong. And the goal here is to find a solution. I want from both of you to hear what you think should be a solution. In my opinion, Jordan is 50% Palestinian by origin. Noam Chomsky is amazing at linguistics, and a lot of the facts he put out may appear true, but they're not. Same thing goes for clearing the Gaza Strip. So I want to hear, how do you guys think we can solve this problem? Not
okay, so the question is, what is your ideals of a solution?
Well, pretty simple. The world has had a solution. The basic contours of a solution have been accepted by the entire world, with the exception of the United States and Israel. And I think they're pretty sensible. I think it's an ugly solution, but probably the best short-term one. Everyone knows what it is.
Which is?
A two-state settlement. It's pretty much what was presented in the 1976 Security Council resolution that the U.S. vetoed. Two-state settlement on the international border U.S. wording in the earlier years, with minor and mutual modifications. It was a ceasefire line, so you straighten out the line and so on. Guarantees the right of each state in the region to exist in peace and security within secure and recognized borders. That is now the position of essentially the entire world.
Did both sides ratify this? Did both sides, Israel and Palestine, agree?
Thirty more seconds, Professor Chomsky.
Israel rejected it, and the United States vetoed it.
Palestine agreed to it.
Yeah. Pardon?
Did Palestine agree to it?
No. Palestinians supported it.
Did Hamas?
Okay, Cliff. Hamas. We're going to have to cut you off there.
This is 1976. There was no Hamas.
The PLO was not accepting some states.
We'll get you in a second, Ambassador Ross. One second.
I'd like to know Hamas's position. Their official position, you can read it in the Washington Post, the New York Times, and so on, is that they would accept this position. They would accept a state in the currently occupied territories with East Jerusalem as its capital.
Yeah. Thank you. Now, Ambassador Ross.
Hamia, that's Khaled Mishal, that's their official position. They don't like it, but they said they'd accept it.
what Hamas has said is they would accept a long-term truce,
no,
not
that's,
a peace.
They
Thank
also
you.
Said,
that was my understanding
addition,
from my reading as
in
well.
In addition, they said they would accept
Very good linguistics,
a long-term truce. Israel rejects it all. It wants to maintain, to incorporate, integrate within Israel the areas that it wants within the territories. They're not adjacent to the border. Take a look at Maale Adumim. Its boundary, which was built in the 1990s mainly, its boundaries extend to virtually to Jericho. They cut right across the West Bank.
Do I get a chance?
Yep. Go ahead, Professor.
You asked a question about what the solution is. Look, any solution that is based upon moral suasion, we know one thing about the Middle East, moral suasion doesn't work. Just look at Syria. So what I would say, A, there is no, the reason I don't agree with you that Jordan is the answer is because the Palestinians have a separate national identity. And there's only one way to solve this conflict. It's two states for two peoples. There are two national movements. These are two national movements that have been competing for the same space. So you have to have two states for two national movements. The Jewish people get self-determination in a part of historic Palestine. The Palestinian people get self-determination in a part of historic Palestine. The logic of what I said before was 67 and mutually agreed swaps. You will probably have settlement blocks of, you know, Olmert wanted 6.3%. And he was prepared to compensate basically the equivalent, 5.8% territory from Israel, and then use the connection between Gaza and Israel to make up for the rest. You're going to end up with something that looks like that. You're going to have security arrangements. The security arrangements, some of which will be extended for a longer period of time, the security arrangements should be driven by conditions and performance. You know, we can pick certain times, but for sensitive areas, particularly given all the unknowns in this region right now, performance and conditions should shape this. And that way you end up with what's going to be two states for two peoples. You're going to end up with Jerusalem being undivided, but a capital for the Israelis, a capital for the Palestinians. The way to deal with the refugee question is that the right of return for refugees will be to their state, not to Israel. The Israelis will be treated like third countries, that they will allow some Palestinians to return, probably under humanitarian rubric. And that's the way you're going to resolve this. And now, you know, it's easy to say and hard to do. The level of distrust between the two sides goes beyond the issue of distrust. It's disbelief. There's a loss of faith on each side. You know, Palestinians ask the question, if the Israelis are really committed to two states, why are they building in what should be our state? And Israelis ask the question, if the Palestinians really believe in two states, how come you can't find a map in the Palestinian Authority with Israel on it? How come, you know, they can't agree to the idea that two states means their state, but also then a state of the Jewish people? So each side then convinces themselves of why the other isn't committed. The key to peacemaking right now is not just to figure out a way how you negotiate on the core issues. How do you get each side to address the sources of disbelief on the other about commitment to two states? So what can the Israelis do to prove to the Palestinians that they, you know, when they say they are committed to two states, that their behavior reflects it? One way would be don't build except in the blocks that will end up being part of Israel. And for the Palestinians, one way is to say, look, we accept there's two states for two peoples. These are two national movements, and there won't be a reconciliation until both sides have a state.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
On the left, go ahead.
Hello, my name is Catherine. I'm a senior concentrated Middle East Studies here. We could debate the causes of the conflict and assign blame to both sides ad nauseum. But Ambassador Ross, I'm glad you brought up the distinction between values and interests, because I was wondering, what are America's strategic interests in the region, and how does America's support for Israel impact the pursuit of those interests?
I can tell you with the way we've defined them historically. We've defined them in terms of ensuring the free flow of and access to oil. We've defined them in terms of our commitment to Israel's security. We've defined them in terms of dealing with potential sources of terror. And we've wanted to make certain that no foreign power could gain some kind of basic leverage over the region. That's the way it's been defined historically. Now, one question that might be embedded in what you're asking is, does the fact that the United States is becoming increasingly independent when it comes to oil, is that going to change America's interest in the region? That's not what you're asking, but I'm just commenting. No, I think what you were getting at is, does our relationship with Israel harm us in the Arab world? Is that what you're getting at?
That's exactly what I'm getting at, yes.
Yeah. I think that there has been an embedded assumption throughout, and it goes back actually to before the time that Israel existed. William Eddy, who was the interpreter for Franklin Delano Roosevelt when he met with Ibn Saud in the Great Bitter Lakes in February 1945, wrote him a memo and basically said to him that we won't ever have friendship with the Arabs, they won't do anything with us if we support a Jewish state in the area. What's interesting is the fact is when we did, those Arab states that we had a relationship with, we still had a relationship with. I'll cite you another interesting example. I'm not saying that it doesn't put Arab states, it doesn't complicate the relationship at times or make them defensive about the relationship, but to give you an example, in 1963, the United States was providing $44.5 million worth of arms to five Arab states. In 1968, those same five Arab states, we were providing $995 million worth of arms. After the 1967 war, there wasn't one of those Arab states that wanted us to stop the provision of the arms, because they saw the arms as being a symbol of the connection. And what mattered for them first and foremost was their security. And they looked at the connection to us as being central to their security. So the US relationship with Israel certainly affects the psychology and the climate within many Arab states. But there's also an interesting reality. What their priorities are tends to be their security. And in the first instance, if you look at a country like Saudi Arabia today and you ask them what are their two preoccupations today,
30 more seconds.
And the other is the Muslim Brotherhood. Israel doesn't rank up there as highly as you might think.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Hi, this is for Ambassador Ross. I'm going back to the point that's already been mentioned, actually, but how in a tough neighborhood, Israel is essentially, a very free state. And I'm wondering, based on American values and based on your own experience, how America justifies itself by supporting a state that just instituted segregated busing systems or, that as an American citizen, born and bred, cannot fly into Israel on a plane because I am Palestinian or the military occupation that is happening. And I just want to know, based on values, on this country's values, how we justify supporting another country that does not, adhere to those values.
Well, one of the things that one of the things I was suggesting is obviously the relationship with the Palestinians today and the nature of the occupation today creates a set of complications for sure. But we look at this state, and as I said, this is a state that is a democratic state. It does embody a set of democratic values. Many of the things that it does with the Palestinians still have access to Israeli courts. Is the occupation something that creates real problems for the Palestinians? Of course. Has there been an effort to negotiate peace? Yes. Does Israel embody a set of values in terms of how it organizes itself, runs itself, in terms of the things I was describing with regard to free elections and free press? Yes. So, one of the reasons that the United States supports Israel because fundamentally it is a democracy in a region where democracy doesn't exist.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentleman on the left, please.
Hello, my question is, why do you think United States is the right broker? Because based on the polls Professor Chomsky mentioned, I don't think Palestinian people trust in the U.S. And then they look at it as like a more of a de-stabilizer of the region. attacking countries in the region, or and the fact that you said it's an effective broker, it is. So, like, I don't think it's an effective broker because there haven't been a deal in, I think, a couple of decades, and then they can't even pursue their side, like Israel, to stop building settlements. Thank you.
Well, obviously, I think that, you know, the United States has been sought by both sides to be the broker. You know, why is it that other countries aren't able to play the role? It's not because we prevent them. Well, I gave the example in the 1990s that the, you know, I didn't prevent the Europeans from being able to play a role. So, you know, one of the reasons that I think that the Palestinians and other Arab leaders look to the United States is because they look to us and they think we're the one country that probably can influence the Israelis, because we have a relationship. And others, they think, can't. So, you know, it's not simply that the United States arrogates to itself the role, it's that others, even in the region, have wanted us to play the role. And that helps to explain it. You know, do I wish that we could have succeeded by now? Yeah, I do. But I also recited examples from history where there were opportunities that weren't seized upon. And you can't, you know, at the end of the day, the U.S. can't force peace and can't impose peace. The U.S. can try to help bring it about. I think we've tried. You know, obviously we haven't succeeded, but ultimately peace is made between the parties.
Thank you. Gentleman on the right.
Hey, I'm David Katzovich. I'm a sophomore at Brown, and I have a quick question, but if you give me a second. Professor Chomsky, I want to say from the bottom of my heart a very personal thank you. It was your works, Profits Over People, Manufacturing Consent, How the World Works, that were...
All right, let's get to that quick question.
I'll come in a moment. They were catalysts for my political awakening, and very, very personal thank you. It's such an honor to see you speak today. My question is for both of you. What is your view on the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement in America and across the world?
What's my view on the boycott, divestment, sanctions? Well, it depends how they're used. So, for example, suppose that there are, let's take the European Union. European Union has recently taken the position that it will not enter into dealings with Israeli institutions that are involved in maintaining the occupation, okay? That amounts to saying we will not participate in criminal acts. Okay? And it is a criminal act, the occupation. As I said, there's no doubt about that. So I think that makes sense. I think the European Union made a sensible, took a sensible, whether they'll implement it or not is another question, but they took a sensible stand. If people here say boycott a company that's producing from the West Bank, same story. It's saying we will not participate in criminal acts. I think that makes perfect sense. There are other kinds of tactics that I don't think make sense or are principled. You have to ask what they are. You can't say anything general about boycott, divestment, and sanctions. Depends how it's targeted.
I don't favor it because if you look at it, what it calls for, in fact, is a one-state outcome. BDS is about a one-state outcome.
No, that's not
yes,
true.
Yes, they are. Look at what their principles are.
The European Union did not call for one state.
His question was about BDS. I'm answering the question about BDS.
Sorry, he was talking about the tactics. There is something that calls itself a BDS movement. That's a separate question.
That was his question, and I'm responding to his question.
Your question was about Omar Barghouti. Was your question about Omar Barghouti?
Professor Chomsky, I'll return to you for a couple minutes afterwards.
Why don't you tell us what your question was?
Both the tactics, not just in terms of boycotting things that work in the settlements, but also, say, companies like Lockheed Martin that support this.
Also?
Companies, say, like Lockheed Martin that support the occupation, and also the movement itself.
Which, you mean the BDS movement? The BDS movement has no, you know, if you read Omar Barghouti, who defines himself as a spokesman, yeah, he says something. Many of the people in the BDS movement say they would like a one-state settlement. But that's not the question of BDS tactics.
Well, I'm responding to the question that said, what do you think of the BDS movement? My response is that they favor a one-state outcome.
Have you found a formal statement from Omar Barghouti saying that, he's the one BDS movement, saying,
well,
I insist on one-state zone?
He has a principle that says there needs to be a right of return of all Palestinian refugees to Israel, which means...
He says he would like that. But you're the one who asked the question, so tell us, are you interested in the BDS tactics, or are you
interpreting the question as opposed to allowing me to answer it?
The tactics of boycott, divestment, sanctions, what they can do in terms of the situation, the tactics largely of boycott, divestment, sanctions as a means of achieving peace.
Yeah, you're interested in the tactics. If you talk about the movement, there's really no organized movement. There are a couple of people who call themselves the spokespersons.
Any approach in the BDS, one of the principles of BDS is
one state solution aside, what is your view on the tactics of boycott, divestment, sanctions?
Well, that's like saying, that's like saying, Mrs. Lincoln, other than what you saw, how was the play, you know?
There's a very simple, why not be concrete?
All right, Ambassador Ross.
Let's be concrete.
Should we
boycott factories that are producing in the West Bank?
Ambassador Ross, I want you to address both not only your views on the tactics of BDS, but what your understanding of BDS is, and then I'll return to Professor Chomsky for your understanding.
Okay, so I'm starting by saying any movement that supports a one-state outcome is favoring an enduring conflict. There is no state in this region where there is more than one clear national identity that is at peace. And if you want to bring an enduring conflict to the region, then you'll favor a one-state outcome. I don't favor that. Now, as for the tactics, I also don't think that it will be effective.
Professor Chomsky, can you speak briefly about your understanding of the BDS movement and then also your qualification of it, as in what tactics do you believe are effective and what are not?
Sorry, I couldn't hear.
So basically, what your understanding of the BDS movement is, as it seems to differ from Ambassador Ross's.
Well, I can't talk about the BDS movement because it doesn't exist. There is no organized BDS movement. There are people who call themselves spokespersons for it, like Omar Barghouti is the main one, writes the op-eds. The talk about a one-state solution, in my opinion, is just a total waste of time. The two options right now, there are two options. Not one state. One option is the international consensus, the world minus the United States and Israel. That's one option. The other option is that Israel will continue doing exactly what it's doing with U.S. support. You can see what it is. It's no secret. It's pretty much what I described, essentially integrating into Israel whatever parts they regard as valuable, excluding Palestinians who will be left in cantons with a nice town in Ramallah for the elite and imprisoned essentially while Gaza remains under harsh Israeli attack with U.S. support. The talk about, we ought to be clear about what people, you keep mentioning the Gaza rockets. Israel knows precisely how to stop the Qassam rockets, the small rockets that come from Gaza. Very simple. Accept a ceasefire.
Thank you. I'm going to cut you off there because the question was...
Remember what happened.
They accepted plenty of
ceasefires. This is, you can document from Israeli sources, okay? It's not controversial.
Thank you. Gentlemen on the left,
please. May I say what it was? In June 2008, there was a ceasefire. Israel would stop its massive attack on Gaza, and Hamas would stop rockets. It worked. There was not a single Hamas rocket. Read the Israeli government website. They'll tell you, not one until November 4th, 2008, when Israeli forces invaded Gaza, killed half a dozen Hamas militants. At that point, some Hamas rockets returned. Israel rockets went back at a vastly greater scale. There were casualties, as always, all Palestinian. In December 2008, Hamas offered to renew the ceasefire, called for it to be renewed. The Olmert cabinet, Mr. Olmert, his cabinet, considered it, rejected it, and instead launched Operation Cast Lead. That's what happened. If Israel wants to stop the rockets, it knows how.
Thank you.
Thank you, President.
Go ahead on the left.
Thank you. My question is for Ambassador Ross. I was wondering if you can characterize what the caliber of ally Israel is, given that, according to the Associated Press last year, CIA views Israeli Mossad as the biggest threat to U.S. interests in the Middle East, given that Israeli offensive forces have murdered U.S. citizens Rachel Corrie, Furkan Dogan, given that Mossad uses fake CIA, and this is according to Foreign Policy magazine, fake CIA identities when recruiting operatives in the Middle East, given that Israel planes, this is according to LBJ's White House records, in 73 murdered 34 U.S. service members.
Thank you. Go ahead, Ambassador Ross.
Rock on.
I'm going to put you down as undecided on this question. Look, you know, I can assure you that the CIA doesn't view the Israelis as the biggest threat in the region. Having spent a lot of time in the U.S. government, that's not the view of people in the U.S. government.
The CIA operatives I speak with, the case officers, disagree with you, sir, respectfully.
Well, you know, you can find individuals who feel that way, for sure. But, you know, there are also, you know, there are plenty of individuals on the inside who feel just the opposite, who find that the sharing of intelligence with the Israelis, preempting terrorist attacks, developing some of the military capabilities which we've acquired from the Israelis, there's a lot that the Israelis have done for us that have saved American lives. Some of the tactics that we used in Iraq and Afghanistan, a lot of doctrinal things. There's many things that the Israelis have contributed, and many within different administrations would say that, from that standpoint, Israel contributes a lot to us.
Anything that not having to do.
All right, we're going
to
move on. Please. Question on the right. Sorry.
Sure. Yeah. Absolutely.
Go ahead. Question on the right, please.
Just, but I mean, you know, look. If you look at the high-tech industry in Israel, you look at some of the medical innovations in Israel, which we also benefit from. Absolutely, we could do a long list of those.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So the first part of my question is for Professor Chomsky. While I agree with your analysis that for far too long the U.S. has given this kind of support to, like, blind check support to Israel that I disagree with, I do think that the U.S. can play a critical role in leveraging the situation by using their support to get Israel to the table. And so I worry that if the U.S. extracts itself from the situation and we turn it over to direct negotiations because of the current power imbalance, that it would result in a solution that's really unfair to Palestinians. And so I want to ask you, how, if the U.S. were to remove itself from the situation, how would you hope that a two-state solution is achieved that is just and sustainable for both parties? And to that end, Ambassador Ross, I want to know how the U.S. will actually play a role as an effective mediator, which a term you kind of talked about earlier, and especially to that end, distancing itself, or how can the U.S. mediating team operate without interference from the U.S. Congress, which, maybe to put it politely, sometimes has a misunderstanding of what the American Jewish community wants from certain organizations.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Professor Chomsky, why don't you begin?
Okay.
Ambassador Ross, so basically, you understood the question.
Okay,
right?
Yeah, sure. look, I think it's a very thoughtful question, and I think one of the things we have to do as a mediator is, again, focus on what I was trying to get at when I was speaking earlier. The key to mediation is getting each side to focus on the other side's needs. The last thing that each party wants to do when they're dealing in a negotiation is focus on the other side's needs. They only think about their side's needs. The role of the mediator is to find ways to explain you're not going to achieve what is important to you unless you're able to address and ensure that you satisfied what's important to them. Our role at this point, I think, is to do two things. One is to deal with these sources of disbelief. If you create a climate where there's complete disbelief and cynicism on each side, and one of the proofs of it is, look at the polls in Israel today.
69% of Israelis favor a two-state outcome, and 91% believe it'll never happen. That's a function of disbelief and cynicism. On the Palestinian side, the polls are showing a disturbing trend. In the past, the Palestinians supported a two-state outcome by figures that were close to 75 to 80%. There still is a majority, but the majority is now down into the low 50s. That's a function of also believing it isn't going to happen and losing faith in the possibility of it. One of our most important roles is to try to demonstrate that it can be done. And one of the things that has to happen is to address, as I was getting at, the sources of disbelief. If Palestinians see a set of Israeli behaviors that convince them that it'll never happen, then how do we address those behaviors to change those so that the Palestinians see something different? If Israeli public sees the same thing on the Palestinian side that convinces them that Palestinians will never really accept Israel, then what do we do to try to change that perception? What can we get the Palestinians to do? And you won't get, you need to create a kind of parallelism. I have long favored what I call coordinated unilateralism. Truth is, I talked to Sharon before he withdrew from Gaza. And I said to him, the problem with the unilateral withdrawal is you're going to end up benefiting the side that is most in favor of resistance, meaning Hamas. We need two things. You need those who believe in cooperation with Israel. They need to be seen as the ones who deliver this withdrawal, number one. And number two, it can't be only Israel that has responsibilities. Palestinians have to see that they have responsibilities as well. This should be coordinated unilateralism. If you pursue what I'm suggesting, which is not only negotiations on the core issues, but specifically as a list of steps that each side might take that they would coordinate between the two of them that would send a signal to the other that what they doubt about the other side is being addressed. That would be a very useful role for us to play as a mediator.
Thank you. Professor Chomsky.
The question of perceptions, let's take a look at the perceptions on both sides. Palestinians see that Israel occupies Palestine. They see that Israel is viciously attacking Gaza. They see that it has annexed the Golan Heights in violation of Security Council orders. They see developments taking place all the time on the ground, splitting the country up into cantons, making life unlivable, turning Gaza into a prison. That's what they see. There's a way to end those perceptions, stop doing it. What they see in the United States is that the U.S. fully supports it. The U.S. provides the economic, military, diplomatic support, like I gave a list of the vetoes and so on, that allows it to continue. That's what they see about the United States. Now, that's why an overwhelming majority in the Arab world regard the United States as the greatest threat they face. There's a reason for that, because of its actions, right? Not its nice rhetoric. Everyone has nice rhetoric. They see the actions. Well, what are the perceptions that bother the Israelis? The Palestinians formally accepted Israel in 1988. Formally accepted it. Take a look at the PNC declaration. There's nothing more to say. They accepted it. In fact, they'd accepted it tacitly before, but formally in 1988. The Israeli-U.S. reaction, which I've quoted, was to say that Jordan's already a Palestinian state and you can't have another one. Okay?
I do have to correct that. This is just factually not true.
Let me quote it.
No, but you're saying...
You look it up. May 1989 is the Israeli response. December 1989 is the Baker Plan. Look it up.
The Baker Plan had 5 points.
Hold on, Ambassador Ross. Professor Chomsky finish,
I will
please.
Tell you what the Baker Plan said.
I wrote it.
You wrote it, therefore you know that it specifically endorsed.
It did not say anything about Jordan. Zero. It had to do with an Israeli-Palestinian dialogue in the territories.
See, it was
not
very
one word about Jordan.
It was carefully written by a diplomat to try to conceal what it said. What it said is, here's what it said. Take a look.
I can tell you, I'm not that good a diplomat.
We endorse the Israeli position.
It did not.
Look it up.
We're going to agree to disagree on this point. Professor Chomsky, I'm going to give you one more minute to finish, please.
We endorse the Israeli position, which was there cannot be an additional Palestinian state.
That language does not exist in anything that Baker presented.
No, he said we endorse the Israeli position, which says this.
No, that didn't.
All right, look it up.
No, there is no endorsement of the Israeli position there.
Look it up. He said we accept the Israeli position.
I'm interested in knowing who would implement or who would create a two-state solution.
What?
Like, you say you support a two-state solution. I'm curious how you think we would get there. That was my question.
How do you, I didn't understand.
Very briefly, Professor Chomsky, she wants you to address how we would achieve a two-state solution.
How would they achieve a two-state solution?
2 minutes, please.
How would they achieve a two-state solution? Depends what kind of two-state solution. So Israel would be happy with a two-state solution, which allows them to take over the parts of the occupied territories that they are systematically integrating into Israel with U.S. support, and leave a couple of cantons around that could be called Palestine. Actually, this proposal was made. The first Israeli prime minister to support a two-state solution was Benjamin Netanyahu. When he took office in 1996, his Minister of Information was asked by the press, would you accept the two-state solution? And he said, yes, we're going to leave something to the Palestinians, and they can call it a state if they want, or they can call it fried chicken. That's the kind of two-state solution that Israel would accept. There's another kind of two-state solution, the one which the world has been advocating since the 1970s, which the Palestinians explicitly supported, which Hamas endorses, which calls for a settlement on the international border with minor and mutual modifications, that's U.S. official terminology, and then a resolution, a fair resolution of the refugee problem. That's a separate question, and there's no real difficulties about what that would be. It would be pretty much what Ambassador Ross mentioned. Those are the options.
Thank you.
The alternative is that Israel will continue with full U.S. support to do precisely what it is now doing. And we don't have to debate about that, because you can read about it step by step, daily, okay?
Thank you. And unfortunately, due to our time constraints, that's gonna be the last question. And I just wanna close with a few remarks before we break.
One more.
The Janus Forum today is able to provide this space for students to come out to hear our two speakers today. And as much as we appreciate their presence, unfortunately, we don't have the privilege of having them every day. And these are conversations that have been started here today, that both speakers have presented, that the audience has engaged with, in the hopes of this conversation continuing around campus. This is simply the first step in what we hope will be a fruitful discussion around campus that will continue through all your times at Brown. And the Janus Forum is able to host events such as this because of student involvement and because of student interest. So with that being said, I want to invite all of you to submit ideas to Janus for future events. And finally, let's give a big round of applause to our two speakers.